Gas chromatography is all about the separation of chemicals based upon their behavior as gases. The standard procedure is, of course, to inject a liquid into the GC. The liquid would typically be a solvent type material carrying the analytes. This small amount of liquid, like a microliter, is injected into a heated space. The heated space immediately vaporizes everything and then is then swept into the column as gases and separated as gases. For some low boiling analytes, you can just inject the gas as a gas and don't even do the liquid business at all. One of the approaches that uses this is called Headspace gas chromatography. The basic idea is to put the sample in like a test tube, heat the test tube up a little bit, and then inject the vapors over the liquid with using a regular syringe. Just inject the gas, the headspace, which is over the liquid. Just inject the headspace itself. Don't do liquid at all. Headspace can be used for small alcohols up to about C5, small carboxylic acids like fatty acids up to again to about C5 or maybe as high as C7, small amines, alcohols. We look at this chromatogram and we can see, for example, for this one that it has ethyl butyrate, isoamyl acetate, ethyl isovalerate, benzaldehyde, which is an aromatic compound. But this is a flavoring standard for chocolate. Maybe you could use it for like fermentation, like for beer, for wine perhaps. Here's one that has, these sort of look like hazardous waste, methyl ethyl ketone, ethanol I think would be a peak that comes right in here, methanol, isopropanol, ethyl acetate, methyl ethyl ketone, and propanol would come out of this scan, benzene, styrene, ethylbenzene, all the xylenes would come out on this one. And then this one is, this one shows chlorinated hydrocarbons like carbon tetrachloride and ethylbenzene and diethylbenzene, methylene chloride, things like that will come out on this acetone. So there's a wide variety of things that you can analyze with Headspace gas chromatography. This approach is usually done with an autosampler. The autosampler uses small proprietary bottles that are about maybe 10 mils a piece or something like that. The sample is aliquoted with an internal standard into these vials. The vials in the autosampler are pulled up like into a heated turret or something like that. They kind of disappear into the instrument. And then according to a computer controlled by the operator, they're heated up for a certain period of time and then injected for a certain period of time. It's my image of it is that it's usually automated with an autosampler. The autosampler will be heating like 1, 2, and 3 samples at a time. And then at the same time, it's analyzing one. So it's constantly cycling them through the heating phase and then into the analysis phase. Some of the autosamplers have a mechanism for shaking the sample immediately before it's injected. I worked in a toxicology environment for quite a few years. I worked in 2 different laboratories. The first laboratory was a hardcore clinical toxicology laboratory supporting police departments, coroners, emergency rooms. We did things like forensic specimens for coroners. The police find somebody passed out in the street and they want to know what kind of drugs they're under. Somebody has a poisoning or suspected poisoning, things like that. The laboratory did about 50 ethanol quantitations a week. I'd do maybe 2 or 3 on my shift every night. We did them by hand. We just pipette the internal standard and the sample into a tube, put a little rubber stopper on it, and then put it in a heating block, and then inject it into the GC using an ordinary syringe with a lure lock needle on it. Inject maybe half a mil or something like that. This was all done with an internal standard. So you'd aliquot your sample and internal standard into a control standard, and then sample, and just inject them by hand. The signal went into a strip chart recorder, and we just measured peak height and do manually. It wasn't really a problem, and we didn't do that many of them. Later on, I started working in a big medical laboratory, and a lot of my responsibility there was doing forensic blood alcohol for police departments, like drunken drivers. The police would send a kit containing two blood samples really directly to me, and I would open them and treat them just by myself, no intervention from the laboratory around me. But I had an auto sampler that took care of everything, and then the auto sampler had a little tabletop integrator which did all the work for us. The samples were run in duplicate. The analysis was amazingly precise and amazingly accurate, and you had a constant monitor of the quality of the analysis based upon the duplicate results. If the duplicates are coming out the same sample after sample, you have a very confident assurance that the analysis is precise and accurate. I had an autopipetter which would very precisely, very reproducibly portion out the internal standard in the sample. And I think that was a lot of the key to the precision of the analysis. It wasn't particularly to my credit. It was more to the fact that I had very good equipment. And during those years, I did probably tens of thousands of injections and never had a problem with it. I aliquoted them into the proprietary tubes and did a septum seal, used a septum closer on the top of it, and they disappeared into the instrument and came out, the results came out on the strip chart recorder, and I'd process them and send the reports out to the police departments, and testified in court, not extremely often, but very regularly for a number of years. Sometimes I think that there's not enough cross-pollination in science. If you're doing a research project or any kind of quality control project, look at your analytes, and if they're very volatile, consider doing it by Headspace. You can do the method development by hand. Just get a heating block and some test tubes, aliquot a sample plus an internal standard into the test tubes, maybe a mil, 2 mils total or something like that. Just put some parafilm on top of it, put it in the heating block, and just do the injection by hand, about a half a mil with a regular syringe, and see what you get. And if the results look promising, go to your managers and see if you can't scare up some money and buy an autosampler. The autosamplers are expensive, but they're very robust, and they'll last a long time, and the precision of the Headspace analysis with an internal standard, if it's done carefully, is better than anything I've personally ever seen.